Being here feels like you're in a different world from daily city life. You know, having to cross so many roads and parking lots and highways to get here.
Land stewardship and the desire to connect with nature has grown exponentially since COVID.
For many people, their local park is the closest they're ever going to come to the wilderness.
There are several land steward organizations and groups in Ontario. Today, I met up with two, Don't Mess With The Dawn and Toronto Nature Stewards, who work in partnership with the University of Toronto Daniels Forestry. Toronto Nature Stewards have an agreement with the City of Toronto Urban Forestry, stewarding 42 sites throughout Toronto to conduct community-based ecological restoration. They are entirely privately funded.
Sometimes with the bigger ones, it's good to work in pairs because you have to lean the buckthorn over, you grab it, and again, sometimes you have to sever the roots with loppers. Pair up with somebody who's done it before. It actually is an amazing machine. These cost about $200. We have about 30 of them.
Nice. Great job.
This is a jack in the pulpit, and I've never seen one in Toronto, ever. And to see one here, like adjacent to a parking lot in Sunnybrook, is just remarkable. When you clear all the buckthorn, all the stuff that was asleep for all these decades, because urbanization came in and the buckthorn came in, it's all just waiting.
Another one. Oh,
that's another one.
Yeah, that is another one.
It is really inspiring coming here and doing work because, yeah, seeing the change is so huge. So it's like somewhere nearby, like in Toronto, where you can actually do this kind of work. You have like support doing this kind of work, seeing native plants come up, and like it's just so addictive.
Right here, these are a spring ephemeral, the May apples, and this is going to be the most beautiful white little flower. Absolutely gorgeous. All these seeds were here. And once we took the buckthorn out, they had enough light and air that they could come up.
Oh, there we go. And now we can allow this ash tree to grow undisturbed. There you go.
I don't think I've ever seen trilliums like this before.
Really? Yesterday I just saw like a four-stemmed trillium.
Yeah.
With like, it was one single flower.
Toronto boasts 11,000 hectares of natural green space. That's 17% of our land mass. That's a lot.
The city forestry, parks and recreation will never have enough money in their budget to take care of it the way they'd like to. So they actually need everyone in Toronto to help keep the parks as beautiful as they can be.
Invasive plants often become a strong monoculture, overtaking areas of our forest floor.
You know, disturbance is healthy too, because it creates space.
It's important we reduce these invasive plants as they weaken the health of the ecosystem, reducing food sources for pollinators, birds, fish, animals, and plants.
And I see you're carrying a branch of buckthorn in your hand. I wonder how many people recognize this and how many recognize that how bad or detrimental it is to the environment here in our ravines and parks.
You know, in my experience, not too many people will recognize this plant. The average person will not know anything about it.
I wonder how we can scale this up, like to have more awareness that people can, you know, drive down the highway or walk in the park and recognize it, that's the one that we shouldn't have in our cities.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think education comes in so many different streams. One of them is, I don't think they sell buckthorn anymore, but a lot of the other invasive plants are still sold in nurseries.
Yeah.
So a lot of the work that stewards do in removing them, it just takes, you know, one stray plant from a garden to fill up a whole forest, like the scout weed. Yeah. That plant is still
supposedly
actively,
remedy for gout, but yeah, you know,
actively sold in nurseries.
These sites are managed by lead stewards who learn to follow an agreed-upon protocol for ecological restoration.
We have some senior Toronto Nature Stewards people here. How many sites do you steward now?
42.
42 sites. And I met Anna just down at Cherry Beach, stewarding a site on the weekend. Don't Mess With The Dawn, predates these guys. We are now entering our seventh year. We do stewardship down in Sun Valley, but we've also removed 300,000 pounds of garbage. We do trail running, mountain biking. We're working on kayaking, and we do sports of all sorts and arts programs. This is Bruce, one of our incredible volunteers.
Oh, look at these sedges. They're seeding. They're so cute.
There are many aggressive invasive species that do not contribute to the ecological function of our urban forests.
Garlic mustard. It was introduced as a cash crop because you can actually use it in cooking.
It's aggressive and it's non-native, and so it just doesn't let other things grow, and that's generally what we take out for the most part to kind of encourage diversity.
One of the top aggressors is knotweed.
Did I ever tell you a story about how I discovered Japanese knotweed?
No, I didn't hear about that.
So I had a PhD candidate and a master's student come to my door, and they wanted to survey the ravine behind my house. And it was part of a study that they were doing, looking at how the ravine had changed in the last 40 years.
Okay.
Since 1977, when they did the same study. And they came in the back, and the forestry guy goes, "Hey, you might want to get rid of that Japanese knotweed." And I said, "The what?"
Okay.
And he's like, "The Japanese knotweed, it's really invasive. It's on the top 10 worst plants in the world list." And I was like, "What? What kind of a list is that?" So he said, "Just Google it." So of course I frantically Googled it and found out it was growing in people's like living rooms. And
really?
Through asphalt and through brick. And,
oh, and like it'll destroy the foundation?
It destroys everything. Like, it's such a robust plant. And so, anyway, this is it. Kind of resembles bamboo.
Right.
So we pull it 3 times a year because it's a really prolific plant. And so what you have to do is stop it from photosynthesizing, because the photosynthesis obviously grows all the roots and makes it stronger. So you don't want it fortified. You have to pull it 3 times. We do it once in May, once in midsummer, and then once again the season.
It's amazing what lies beneath the invasive species covering our forest floors.
Well, this was another remarkable thing. It was kind of like the trilliums that we just saw in Sunnybrook, because the jewelweed unexpectedly came out when we pulled all the knotweed out. So again, it was like just sleeping here, and we just released it.
Here's a familiar friend. It's goldenrod, which is the most common native species in Toronto and a huge part of Ontario. They are really, really common, especially in the city here, because they're, you know, the word invasive is really relative, so they're actually invasive in other parts of the world. And that's because of their ability to grow in tough and difficult places. So here, I mean, they're considered a friend because they, once again, are feeding our wildlife and are locally adapted. So this is probably the most common native species that you'll find here in Toronto. Right next to the goldenrod is a little shoot of a plant called dog strangling vine that's originally from Europe. And so this is a very highly invasive plant here. You can kind of think of it as, you know, maybe the goldenrod, the dog strangling vine would be the goldenrod of Europe and vice versa.
Our forests and ravines in the city are weakening and are dying because of, at the base level, these plants are taking over. And over years, now next time there's a windstorm, there's a heavy rainstorm, these trees don't survive because they're weak at the bottom now. And once they're gone, that has a much more negative impact, even after a heavy rainfall event, which then translates into larger economic, you know, insurance losses and property damages and so on and so forth. So what we may think as a benign, yes, this plant is not good, but you know, it really is not affecting me so much. Well, it does when you start looking at that level. It's not a little bit of money. It's, you know, that's billions of dollars, right? And it's gonna have a compounding effect because these things continue to happen. They continue to spread. it really needs a very concerted campaign through the provincial government, I think, where everybody knows what these plants are. When wherever I see them, I need to remove them.
The variety of plants, even in a small area, could help to mitigate floods. And the more variety of plants you can fit in, the greater the cooling effect it can have on our heating planet.
I had a big group who came to my site last year, and I was explaining to them the difference between, you know, the buckthorn and the DSV and how it's rampant and what the negative impacts it's having. And they're like, Najib, I'm realizing that not all green is good. And then the next time they came, he's like, now I drive down DVP of 401 and I see buckthorn and I see DSV, the dog strangling vine everywhere.
Yeah.
And now it affects me because I'm like, oh, up until last week, I thought this was great because it's lush around Don Valley Parkway.
Yeah.
But now I can differentiate and like, no, it's lush, but it's not the right kind of green that we should have.
Right? And so, speaking of roads and highways, they are pathways for invasive plants to spread across Ontario. Like you'll see, I think the most eye-catching one is the Phragmites that you'll see along Ontario highways.
It is just
this tall grass, looks kind of like wheat almost.
Yeah.
But you'll just see, like, if you're driving on the highway, you'll see the whole side of the highway.
And every year we see it spreading.
So what can you do as an Ontarian to keep your natural forests, waterfronts, and wetlands thriving?
Come out, help out, start to educate yourselves about the biodiversity issues that we're facing. And if you like trees and you like nature and you like other people, then come out. It's really good for your mental health. You know, we are losing biodiversity at an alarming rate, so this is something that you can actually do to help.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what about educating yourself before you go to buy your plants for your garden?
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
That people who are selling don't necessarily know.
Yeah, that's always tough.
And it's a big industry, right?
Public spaces here are all of our backyards.
Yes.
It doesn't belong to the city. It belongs to all of us. And so we have an obligation to look after it.
Thank you for all the work you guys do. It's incredible.
Thank you for taking an interest. It's important.
Turn around.
Volunteer lead steward. You earned that shirt.